Good afternoon, and welcome to New Foundation Unity. This is our second in a five-day series on 12 oils, 12 powers. Apologies for yesterday to those of you out there who tried to tune in. The problem is fixed with the streaming company. So today, if you do have any technical difficulties, email Mark at truthunity.net and he will help you. If it's trouble with seeing or hearing, email Mark. And for all of you out there, questions, comments, come to 816-301-6304. We have a live class here, and they will be asking questions, but if around close to 2 o'clock or between 2 and 2:30, if you have a question or comment, please call in. 816-301-6304, and I will repeat that later on. And so, as we begin our time together, I invite you to close your eyes for a moment and remember the truth that there is but one power, one presence, one life, one mind, one infinite source, and that source is located within each one of us. The source of infinite good, all that we would ever need for a happy, healthy, fulfilled life. And for a few moments in the silence, let us rest in that awareness of that one source, the source of all good, in the silence. And now, as we have been awakened to that one power and one presence, we are also awakened to those 12 channels of expression that we call the 12 faculties of mind. And in that awareness of the truth, we do give thanks in the name and through the power of the Christ that lives within us all. Amen. One thing I didn't mention yesterday is that if you would like to dig further into this topic, I have here Ed Rabel's course on the 12 powers. These are cassettes. I only have these copies, but you're welcome to borrow them while you're here. Also, the book, The 12 Powers of Man by Charles Fillmore, Christ Enthroned in Man by Cora Fillmore, and Charles Roth also has a book similar to Cora Fillmore. And so those are the 12 power aspects of reference books that if you want to go deeper than what we can go in one class, that is where you would look. Now, I want to begin with, and I did have my Bible here, oh yes, that really the basis for this course, at least Charles Fillmore quotes this. And so I would like to read to you. This is the story. It's found in Matthew 19, 28. And what has happened here is that a rich young ruler has come to Jesus and said, "What do I need to do to gain eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Well, follow the commandments." And he says, "Well, I do that." "Which ones?" "Yeah, okay. I do all that." You know, it's like, "I go to church on Sunday. What more do you want?" No. The man says, "Well, what more can I do?" And Jesus says, "Well, sell all your belongings and give the money to the poor." Oh. I think I better give that a second thought. And he walks away sadly. And the disciples are witnessing this. And they say, you know, if he can't get in to the kingdom of heaven, what about us? We have been following you for these years. We have given all, you know, give up everything and follow me. Well, they did that. And here's what Jesus said. This is verse 28. Jesus said to them, "Truly, I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man shall sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, will receive 100-fold and inherit eternal life. But many that are first will be last, and the last first." Okay, now this sitting on 12 thrones and judging the tribes of Israel, all right, because we are going to talk about the faculty of judgment today, but what he is saying is, essentially, that as the Son of Man, that's a code word for human being, so as human consciousness is raised to the spiritual level, then all of these faculties, which Charles Fillmore compares to department heads, are lifted at the same time. Would the Creator have given you his very own spirit without a way of expressing it? No, because it's God's desire to express in and through you. So we have these faculties, and as we continue to go within and become acquainted with our spiritual self, that in unity we call the Christ, the consciousness of the Christ, then these channels of expression begin to wake up as well. Yesterday we talked about faith, that faith is the first faculty in three of the Gospels anyway, but it's certainly first in our lives. We have to develop a faith which emerges out of our belief. We usually start with a belief. One day we wake up and we say, I think there could be more to life than what I am presently experiencing. Oh, and then you hear, maybe you wind up at a church or you read a book and you learn that you have this potential. And you say, oh, okay, what do I need to do? Well, first of all, it's an invisible presence. You have to believe that it's there. At first, you may not perceive it, but it starts with believing it. And then, as you believe it, put attention on it, faith emerges, which is knowing it is there. Okay. And so, amongst you who were here yesterday, is it really clear what faith is? You never need to pray for more faith. You have as much faith as you will ever have, but it is your direction that you give that faith. And for most of us, we kind of got a foot in both camps. You know? Yeah, God, I believe in God. Oh, but then something happens and, oh, maybe I believe in sickness. Or maybe I still believe in God, but... And that is in degrees because, you know, we affirm there's no condition beyond God's ability to solve, to correct, or to heal. But maybe you have these doubts that maybe there's something that you have, some condition that you're experiencing that is too difficult for God. Okay, so that's where the inner work lies, in making that knowing, turning that belief, the ignition switch, into moving the engine forward. That's faith.
I just got it. So be ye perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect is to be complete in all of these faculties, mm-hmm, in your Christ self, which is your ticket to the regeneration.
That's it. That is it, exactly. So between the Christ and the outer expression are these faculties which bring it out. The Christ doesn't act. The Christ, like God, simply is. And so we have to have a way of expressing it. And it starts with faith. Now, the oil, we talked about the oil, frankincense. And as you will notice on the tables next to you, are some little doilies and some little testing strips. And on those testing strips, if you will look, there are some little red lines. Okay. Now, if when the oil comes around to you, okay, and the mats are the little doilies are there for you, so you won't get oil on the table, okay, or on the rug, then you can take a couple of drops if you like the oil and you want to keep it with you for a while. Put it in between where those two little red lines are. I've had people tell me it has lasted up to a week. Amazing. But it's just to kind of remind you. So if, you know, we've already passed frankincense around, but it's still here. So you can have that. And the same with each of the oils. We next talked about strength, represented by Andrew. Andrew is Peter's brother. Andrew, when your faith wavers, and you start thinking, oh, well, yeah, I believe in God, but what about this? Then you call upon your consciousness of Andrew. Andrew, who represents strength, which is located in your lower back. And remember that the importance of the oils, the seat of faith, is in the pineal gland. Charles Fillmore knew that. And the oils go directly through the sense of smell is wired directly into the limbic region of the brain, which is why it's direct. You go direct. All the other senses go through the cerebral cortex, which is the analyzing and the dissecting and the intellectual, so you'll reason things out before you act. All right? This is how the emotions that have been lodged in our cells get freed. And that is through the pineal gland, which directs all those hormones and molecules and messenger molecules to heal. Okay, and we had the oil of cypress. And these oils, it was my idea to put them together because there's an uncanny match. Cypress, that's not it, but cypress is here from yesterday. It's a very, very strong wood. And it's what Noah was directed to use. Gopher wood is reckoned to be cypress. And the doors of St. Peter's and, yeah. So cypress, it was used also in Solomon's temple. One other thing that I didn't mention yesterday, but I think it's important for you to know about the oils, is that in the plant, this is the distilled essence of the plant or the tree, the lifeblood, as it were, and it serves to give nutrients to the cells of the plant. It also serves to take waste away from the plant. It also heals the plant if it's bruised or in some way. And the uncanny thing is that the chemistry of these oils is the same as in human blood. And so these oils oxygenate the blood. They're tiny molecules. You remember, they can penetrate the cell walls. And one other thing that is almost equally important, perhaps equally important, is that it is an antioxidant, right? It both oxygenates the blood and it eats up the free radicals, which are believed to be responsible for disease. And I was looking at the ORAC scale, oxygen absorption, oxygen radical absorption capacity, that's what it stands for, and the highest above all else is clove oil. And yesterday we talked about thieves. All right? Okay. All right. Also, I wanted to show you a sample of, this is frankincense, and this is myrrh in its kind of more crystalline state. So if you would like to see these, pass them around. Thank you. And we will begin with the next two powers, James and John, represented by another set of brothers. James represents the faculty of judgment. All right? Now, when you think of judgment, you probably have associated it with judgmental. Well, that's when you direct your judgment out here and you say, well, apples are better than oranges. No, it is the faculty, its function is to evaluate, to discriminate, to make decisions. And you say, well, I'll discriminate. I like red better than white, or some such thing. No, it's about saying, I am discerning enough to know truth from error. So a thought comes into your mind, and you can say, oh, yeah, I could become very prosperous if I went to the 7-Eleven and asked for all their money. And then your sense of judgment says, no. Prosperity, yes, but wrong way. All right, that is your faculty of judgment. And James, the faculty, James, the disciple James, his name means supplanter. And so judging by appearance is supplanted by judging righteous judgment. What's righteous judgment? How does God judge? All is good. Remember the creation story? And God said, let there be light, and it was good. And God said, let there be a firmament, that's the faculty of faith, and it was good. And God made man in his image after his likeness, and God said, very good. All right? So everything in creation is good. And so judging righteous judgment is judging from a place where all appears good. You've probably heard the Bible verse that says, God's eyes are too pure to behold iniquity. And why is that? Because the vibration is high and nothing of lesser vibration can come in. That is our faculty of judgment. Peter's name means rock. Okay, it's the rock solid foundation upon which to build a spiritual consciousness. Yes?
I was sitting in a meeting one time at a store teaching their spiritual, and they were using their method of getting to the right place was to actually change the physical, your physical vibration, as opposed to getting intimate with the source and letting the source be intimate with you, right? And becoming, right? They were coming at it externally, yeah, from purely the physical vibration. And that seemed weird to me. Is that a right discernment, or what's the
deal? Yes. Okay, here's the law. We have to look to spiritual law. And the law is first in mind, then in manifestation. Right? First in law, first in mind, then in manifestation. And who in the Old Testament represents judgment? Yes.
Solomon.
Yes. Remember, God went to Solomon. He had a dream. And in his dream, God said, "What would you like?" And Solomon said, "An understanding heart." And God said, "That's good. And in addition, because you haven't asked for this other stuff, you get all of that too." And Solomon was renowned as the wisest and richest king in all of the world. And right following that, he has a chance to show his ability to judge. Two women come to him. Each has had a baby, and one of the babies died. And one woman is accusing the other woman of having stolen her baby. Okay, remember that story? Okay. And so they call on Solomon. And Solomon says, "Okay, cut the baby in half." And one woman said, "If I can't have this child, then nobody should have it." But the real mother said, "Please don't kill the child." All right? That was wisdom. He knew how to find out. There were no lawyers and witnesses and and all of that. All right? Righteous judgment. Okay, and in us, at a deeper level than saying this or that, it's a sense of intuition. You feel, you sense what is the right way. Okay, that's Solomon. Now, the oil that goes with that, cedar wood. We talked about this yesterday, that cedar wood has the highest number of sesquiterpenes. Remember that internal compound which deletes all the wrong ideas, the memories, the misinterpretations that have gotten into our cells and lodged there. Okay, that's cedar wood. Well, here's what Solomon did. And you can read all about this on your sheet that has to do with cedar wood. You will find the passage in 1 Kings where Solomon practically depletes the cedars of Lebanon. He not only built his temple, the temple out of cedar, mostly, and cypress. But he also built his palace, which, by the way, took many more years and was twice as big as the temple. That says something. And more than that, he took cedars and the whole workforce, I mean, thousands of men and all these camels and all of, you know, it was, it caused a revolt in the end. But he brought cedar trees down and planted them in Jerusalem. So wherever you were, if you were in the temple, if you were at home, if you were walking the streets of Jerusalem, You were breathing in wise. You were breathing in this oil from the fragrance of the trees that gives you wisdom. Yes.
Solomon, though, in regard to building the temple,
yeah,
in, as part of his righteous judgment, wasn't there a pattern that was revealed to him from heaven, and so the temple had to be this way? It wasn't at his discretion.
No, but you see, David was not allowed to build the temple. See, all through the wilderness in the Exodus, you know, they went from tents to tabernacles, okay?
The tabernacle definitely was from given.
Absolutely. And yes, it was given from above, but it was not David who was allowed to build it, because he had conquered the kingdom by force. And so it came to Solomon, who had earned the right to build the temple. And most of it, at least on the interior, was cedar wood. Okay, highest, except for vetiver, the highest oil in sesquiterpenes. So how can you help but make righteous judgment? Okay, so you have yours, okay? And if you like cedar wood, I'm diffusing it in the diffuser. I forgot to put my little diffuser on today. I was going to put some cedar wood on, so I would be very wise.
What was the higher one?
Vetiver. It's not, as far as I know, a biblical oil. At least I haven't seen it. But you know, there are a lot of different terms used for essential oils, which is why you may not know how thoroughly saturated the culture was with essential oils. I mean, there's aroma, there's fragrance, there's sacred oil, there's incense. I mean, and the translators didn't know. They just used any word that they wanted. Perfume was another one. All of that. But there are, according to Dr. Stewart, more than 1,000 references either to the oils or the plants from which the oils were derived. The whole culture, especially in Old Testament times, this was their way for not just healing, but for keeping the temple pure. It was for embalming, as it were. It was for hospitality. You know, people didn't have shoes. They either walked barefoot or with sandals. So they would arrive at a place with dusty feet, and a good host would show hospitality by washing the feet and using oil. And we'll read a story in just a bit about that. Hospitality, primary value in Hebrew culture. Okay, this is judgment. So out here, it's like we make judgments all the time. We judge our food. We can't eat anything, not a simple ice cream cone, without having some judgment about sugar or fat or, you know, and so. But here, you intuitively know, I can eat an ice cream cone if I want to. Okay, it's the same faculty, but just more refined. Okay, so if you have been making unwise decisions, call on your consciousness of James, and if you have your sheet handy, read to me what the affirmation is for the faculty of judgment. Oh, and show that picture, show everybody the picture of the cedar tree. It's a huge tree. The cedars of Lebanon are no more. Thank you, Solomon, but.
He didn't use their judgment.
He did not use.
Cedars now, do you know anything about cedars now? I mean, they are so prolific that they're considered a weed around here.
Really?
here, a weed. Oh, please. There's lots of cedar trees in Oregon, but I don't know around here. They're magnificent trees. People have tried to, figure out what it was, what exactly the cedar tree looked like. These are not pictures of Lebanese cedars.
Where's the affirmation? I don't see an affirmation.
Okay, do you
or is it part of a separate handout?
It's a separate handout.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. Okay.
Through Christ, I discern the truth of my being.
Okay, all right. So that's the ultimate that is the ultimate discernment of truth. If you have discerned that truth, then all of your channels will awaken to express that truth. And remember, the reason you were created was for God to express through you and as you. You are a beneficial presence in this world.
So the oils, because it's mind and then expression, right?
First in mind, then expression. First in mind, then in manifestation. Yeah.
In manifestation.
Yeah.
And so what we do is we become awake to the power, and then we use the oil to help our body cooperate with that mindset.
The oil, and they knew this in ancient times, but we've lost this since. But the oils, because this is part of a holistic system, they knew in ancient times that it was the stored, unprocessed emotions that were the cause of disease. Okay? And the oils work on that. It's like the Creator designed everything for our healing. If the Creator's desire is to express through us, it's also the Creator's desire to sustain us. And these, Ezekiel 47:10, this is what was provided for our healing. Humanity's first medicine. Okay. And if these oils were and are applied with prayer, even more so, and these oils are prayer, as you know from their function. Prayer isn't just words. In fact, prayer can be completely silent, but prayer has a certain frequency, and these oils lift you to that same frequency. Okay? All right. And so cedar is the one that allows you to discern that ultimate truth about yourself. That's the truth you have to know as intensely as you know the truth that if I drop this phone, that it will fall to the floor. There's no doubt about that.
So the Elohim, Yahweh, of the Old Testament has been given a bad rap, because what we're seeing here is there's this intense, ubiquitous provision for healing and for overcoming, and all we ever hear about the Old Testament is judgment. But the provision is there, but it's all over the place.
The story of the Old Testament is a story of the evolution of the consciousness of the presence of God. And sure, but the provision has always been there, which is why we can find it and express it. Yes, Elohim, divine mind. Jehovah, that's God individualized as us, as the Christ. Yes. And then if we have this awakening, automatically these channels of expression, okay? Okay, mind, Elohim, idea, son, Or we say Christ when you see Lord in the Old Testament, that's the Christ of the New. And then expression. We are here to express God fully in every way. So it's a noble purpose, and we have a chance to be, as it says in Psalm, I forget which, do you not know ye are God's?
62:6.
Thank you. I have a Bible scholar right here. Okay, so are we clear about judgment? Okay. Now, if we stay up here on the level of human consciousness, then that's the kind of judgment that Jesus warns us is like a boomerang, that as you judge, you will be judged. And so when we hear that word judgment, we don't think of wisdom. We think of judgmental. And there is a lot of that. But if we know that it acts that way, that what we give out, it comes back to us big time. So that's something to look out for, all right? And we judge from deep inside and know the truth that I am a spiritual being. I've done my share of judgment in that outer way, as some of you know. Okay, now the next one is love. And by the way, judgment is located right here in the solar plexus. That is sun. Solomon is called sun man. Solomon, and this is the solar plexus. Yeah, so Solomon. And love, remember James and John are brothers, and right behind it, the solar plexus is called the brain of the body. Okay, that's like, okay, turn left, turn right. You know, it's like you make these intuitions on the basis of your discernment. And love, which is located behind the heart, and they're like right next to each other. And when they function together, love and judgment, we have wisdom. Okay. When you judge with love of righteousness, you have wisdom. Now, John, and there's a really interesting story about the oil that represents love. But I'll tell you first about John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. He rested his head in the tableau of the Last Supper. You see John resting his head like right here on Jesus, right by his heart. Love is the unifying power of the mind. We think of love as on the human level of affection and, you know, hugging, and or we think of it as in a more superficial Hollywood way. But true spiritual love is knowing your connection, knowing your oneness, oneness with God, oneness with others, and oneness with all life, and that includes all the animals and the plants and the rocks and everything. Okay, that is the function of this faculty. And love is like gravity, right? Gravity. Gravity draws you together. Meditation in the silence, it's gravity that pulls you. As Jesus said, I and the Father are one. Okay, that is the function of love. And you may know that John was the only disciple that was not crucified. Okay, he stayed at the crucifixion. He was there The whole time, the others ran away, including Peter. but love, all right? And there's an affirmation for...
There is no fear in love.
Yeah, right. Now, who represents love in the Old Testament? Chuck.
David,
thank you. Now, why David? Can you think? Why David? Why does David? Well, that's an interesting story. But David united the kingdom. It was the first time unifying power of love. And yes, the song, he did soothe Saul's demons with his music. Yes, he did. Well, this isn't part of the class, but we can talk about it after, of why David's music was so special. Okay, so here is the oil. And by the way, just think that if you are feeling either superior or inferior, and I don't mean just to one another, but if you feel that that is just a cat, then you are speaking untruth about God's creation. Any prejudice you feel, and you know, there are obvious ones that many people are still prey to, but you know, there are others that are more subtle, and so that's something to be mindful of, because love here means usually that you love someone, you know, one person, very exclusive, but love is actually inclusive. And it means that if you are going through an experience of fear or any kind of anything other than love, or if there's hatred, that means you have lost your connection. You should care as much about your friend or your family member as you do about all the people in the world who are undergoing hardship, because what happens to one happens to all, and the whole creation feels the sorrow when, you know, South Carolina is flooding, Afghanistan bombing, all these. And it's like we tend sometimes to think, ah, that's pretty far away. That has nothing to do with me, but actually we are a collective consciousness, and so we want to project into our environment the highest that we possibly can. Okay, we want to project peace. And that often involves the use of both James and John. All right, if we tend to have a lot of judgments about situations and people, well, go a little deeper and call on your faculty of John. And then you see a bigger picture. Okay, it's not, I'm not saying it's easy, but it's something to work toward, yes? Now, so you're clear about why David represents Israel was only a nation for 100 years. until 1948. Okay, after World War II. 100 years. It dissolved after Solomon. There have been invaders, and I was reading that passage on Sunday where it says, you know, we've never been in bondage. It was not only in the Exodus, but the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Greeks and the Romans. It's one continuous bondage. But we're all in bondage to the beliefs that act as a barrier to that expression. And so John is the faculty that allows us to make the connection. One unforgivable sin. Okay? Remember what that is?
To
block entry to the Holy Spirit within you. Now, can you block God? Well, not really, but our minds are not in actuality, but our minds are powerful. And yes, we can block ourselves.
As opposed to letting them make an abode within us.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, here, for Unity people who know the history of Unity anyway, this oil, myrtle, is the oil. Myrtle, you know the story of Myrtle, she was healed of tuberculosis. She had one of those beliefs that she would die fairly soon, according to the doctors and her family. She'd inherited this from her family. Well, I looked up some information on the myrtle tree, which is more like a bush, and found that the leaves are heart-shaped. That's interesting. And then, yeah, you can't see it clearly, but that's what it starts out very small. They're hard to grow, and they tend to grow together. So if you have a myrtle tree here and a myrtle tree here, and they're all little trees, and you have one here and you have one here, they tend to grow into a clump and become one at the trunk. I mean, is that a symbol of oneness? Oh, and so myrtle is an oil that is used today to heal tuberculosis. And I have to tell you that Myrtle was not her given name. Her name was Mary Carolyn, Mary Carolyn Page. But as a child, she got Myrtle-y, or, you know, it was a nickname that she chose to keep because she liked it better. And you know, names are important in the Bible because your name contains the nature of your character. And so by adopting that name of Myrtle, she was in essence carrying with her the essence of her own healing. It's amazing. Okay, you have myrtle oil, right? Herbal. I'll have some of this today.
Can't get too much love.
That's right. You can't ever get too much love. But love by itself, remember yesterday I said no faculty can stand on its own, and love can't either. Okay? And you know why? How do we use it? We use that word. We overuse it. We say, I love pizza. Or I love a movie or a book. I know I do this continually. And if you love is very indiscriminate. So you need to have James with John. You need to have some judgment, some discrimination. If you just love everything and everybody, you have no boundaries. And wisdom says, and then your judgment comes. He says, well, maybe not. Yeah, maybe not.
Wow. It's easy to see now Peter, James, and John.
Yeah, so you see two sets of brothers, and those four form the foundation of spiritual consciousness. In the Transfiguration, do you know what the Transfiguration is? Yes, I know you do. Jesus went up on a mountain. Now, that's a code for saying higher consciousness. And he was transformed before them. Peter, and he took with him Peter, James, and John. Those were the three disciples. So he took his faith, he took his judgment, and he took love. And so here he is in higher consciousness, and the disciples say, oh, well, should we build three booths? Yeah, that's Peter. All right, where is our faith here? A one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Okay, Moses represents the law, and Elijah represents the prophets. And so Jesus then, you know, the Christ, God, the law, the prophets are all one, and he was transfigured. And the disciples were afraid. And sometimes people are afraid to go into the transcendent for fear of not coming back. And then they looked and, oh, there was just Jesus there. That was all. So it is all one. Okay. Okay. And also, if there's anybody who's tuned in, and it is 2:00, so if you would have any questions or comments on where we have been so far, and you all have affirmation sheets, so if you look at those, you can decide. Also, yesterday, and this is more for those of you who were not able to tune in, I described how on the way to developing these faculties, it develops unevenly. And it's more like an amoeba, like some days your faith is strong and other days it wavers. And some days your love is strong and other days you feel really judgmental. And you know, and so it's kind of like that. And so the purpose of the affirmations, in case you have forgotten the truth, is to remind you, that's all. Okay, none of these do the work for you. It's to remind you. And then when you have the experience, then you can affirm from a place of silence on the basis of your experience. That is, so there's two purposes for the affirmation. You can't just use affirmations as a club and pound your way into any of these faculties. You cannot take the kingdom by force. And some people do use affirmations as though they were a big club. Let me in. That is not the purpose. The affirmations are statements of truth, but they are statements of truth, not the experience of truth. But once you've had the experience of your truth as a spiritual being, the affirmations become an affirmation of what is the truth in your experience. It's like, it could be silent. It's like, oh, I am a spiritual being. Oh, I am whole and well. I am abundantly blessed. Okay, but that's only real from one level. On other levels, you may know, I just need to be reminded of the truth. And so you can refer to these affirmations. And you say, yeah, I forgot that I do have good judgment. I forgot that I am connected to everyone in creation.
So we awaken to the possibility and then affirm that truth and bring it into our experience, and then we know it.
And then we know it. That's right. And so affirmation is like the belief that ignites the knowing. Yeah. That's good. All right. Well, no, everyone is shy about calling in. 816-301-6304. So did everybody get some myrtle oil? Okay. And any questions here about the powers so far and how they work? No? Okay. So now this is an interesting, the next one. We're going to at least begin on power and spikenard. This is this faculty of power. If you want to, it's the power of the mind to transform. Okay? Spiritual power, as opposed to power out here. Power out here is to control others or countries or whatever. Power in here is to transform. It's through spiritual power drawn from within that we transform consciousness from the limited state of human consciousness to the spiritual state. And that disciple is represented by Philip, the lover of horses. Right? It's Philip, the lover of horses. And horses, they're strong. Okay, they're strong. Philip is one of the less developed ones in the Gospels. At the feeding of the 5,000, here's, 5,000 come for dinner, and Jesus asks Philip, who is the disciple representing power, how are we going to feed all these people? Now, it wasn't that Jesus didn't know, but he was testing. It's like Jesus tests his own faculties on the way to the crucifixion and resurrection. So if you look at the miracles, in quotes, I'm going to say miracles, but if you look at what are called the signs of the Messiah, you will find that they increase in difficulty. Okay. Now, but the first step of establishing a foundation for your power is found in the wedding at Cana. All right. Wedding at Cana. If you don't know it, I recommend that you read it. The wedding at Cana is a marriage between your thinking and your feeling. Many do not get this because John is the most metaphysical of all gospels. You say, well, where's the bride here? Well, thinking is on the conscious level. Feeling is on the subconscious level. So you can't see the bride. But the action betrays the level of consciousness. All right, so read The Wedding at Cana, John chapter 2. And when the marriage, immediately after the marriage, oh, and Jesus, Jesus was invited to the wedding, but he was a PS. He was not the star of the show. Mary was invited to the wedding, and Jesus with his disciples was there also. Okay, just to point that out. But in this story, Jesus becomes the Christ and turns the water of human limitation into the wine of spiritual consciousness. And they drank it and said it was the best ever. Okay, so that's what that establishes. That's the only way that power can flow through you, is when you've established harmony between your thinking nature and your feeling nature. And how do you do that? By going within to where you know your oneness, going into the silence where you are one. And each time, it's not that it happens instantaneously like in the story, but over with practice, you revisit and you revisit and you revisit until that truth becomes stronger than anything out here. Yeah.
You know what just came to mind was two things. First, with the wedding feast of Cana, is that Jesus demonstrated only after he submitted to the divine feminine, his mother. You know, his mother said,
Do something.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes.
Yeah, and he says, it is not my time, but it became his time when she turned, she went to the servants and said, do whatever he tells you. So there was a surrender on both parts. And yes, good point, because there is this relationship between the masculine, which is the thinking, and the feminine, which is the feeling. The feminine is on lead, and the masculine obeys. The conscious mind is a lousy master, but a wonderful servant. We rely on our intellect, our thinking nature, to bring things forth, but it's the feminine part of our nature. And that's what this story, that is how our spiritual power emerges. The wedding at Cana. And then following that, then there's healing, distant healing, you know, kind of blind faith, all right? And we have the man at the pool of Bethesda. He's just there to be healed, you know? He thinks he has to go into the water, but actually Jesus shows him otherwise. And he learns the source of healing. That's important. Not just the healing. You have to know where it comes from. And that's kind of after the main part of the story. And then we have the feeding of the 5,000. Now we're getting into where we really need some heavy-duty power to manifest out of a little, a great deal, enough to feed everyone. Yeah.
And it seems, and the other thing that I noticed there just before the wedding feast of Cana is that with these disciples that are with him,
yeah.
You know, he goes, Jesus sees John, and John tells his disciples to follow Jesus, right? And then, but then it says that Jesus desired to go into Galilee, and Jesus found Philip, and then there's no more said. But John is the intermediary that leads, John the Baptist that leads John and Andrew. Andrew goes and finds Peter. Philip finds Nathaniel, but Jesus found Philip. Jesus found Philip.
That's Jesus interesting.
Found Philip.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll look at that.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
And of course, after Pentecost, then Philip regained that real power. And when thinking and feeling meet, it happens right here. It happens in the larynx, where the vibration, it's like basically a vibrating box, And when the vibration is high, you speak, you think, and you act from a place of power. That's what Jesus, that's what the teaching of Jesus is all about.
Yeah, that we're in it now.
We're in it. It's kind of like there's a great polarization because it has been so masculine dominant for so long that it's like it's making a last ditch stand. But not to fight it. You know, we tend to want to fight. You know, we fight this disease, or we fight poverty, or we fight, you know. And Jesus taught non-resistance. You know, and that doesn't mean lie down on a mat and say, "Come and get me," but just be in a place inside where you're not affected so greatly by.
You know, and it was the divine feminine that brought about the conversion of the native Mexicans, because the Catholic priests could not make any conversions until the apparition of Mary on the mount of the mother goddess, the Aztec mother goddess, when Guadalupe came to Juan Diego, and it was at that point that the Mexicans went ahead and converted to Catholicism, and there was a peace between them, and they came in droves by the millions.
Amazing.
It was only until Guadalupe made that intercession that obstacle was broken down. That impasse was broken. It was Mary who did it. It was the church could not do it. The church could not make conversion.
Well, yeah.
Doesn't that raise the question also then whether the whole Western Hemisphere is more tuned into the feminine?
Oh, absolutely. Yes.
As a natural course.
Right. Yes, absolutely.
Well, it's something. And this is an esoteric idea, but I think it's true, and Charles Fillmore mentions this in this book, that when Jesus, actually it's in Atom Smashing Power of Mind, but when Jesus ascended, remember he'd been perfecting these powers, so that he could go down to Jerusalem, go through the crucifixion and the resurrection, and have the disciples spread the message, carry on the ministry. He said that when Jesus ascended, that he dispersed the atoms of his body, his light body, everywhere. And for the first time, made a breakthrough into that fourth dimension, which is why we can transcend so easily. Mm. All right? It was like the earth was encrusted with all of these limitations of thoughts of I can't and impossible and you only live to be 30 and etc.
So is that what it means when Paul says he when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives and gave gifts to men?
Yeah, exactly.
That's what he's talking about.
Yeah, that's right. And so...
Oh, you haven't
yeah.
Yeah.
And so, that's why, you know, there's a piece of that consciousness in every single person. And now, as Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. That's it. He had a laser beam consciousness that no one else at that time had that could penetrate through that layer after layer after layer, and went through into the fourth dimension. And the disciples said, well, why can't we go there too? You know, they wanted to go with him. And he said, you can't, not yet, not yet.
He had some work to do.
Yeah.
And Charles talks about that in the introduction to the 12 powers.
Yeah.
And I just now today understood what he was talking about. The whole regeneration and the completion of the 12
that,
powers.
Yes, exactly.
And
that it is a whole new race in humanity that was begun a couple of thousand years ago when Jesus ascended. And, you know, and things have to be purified out. So if you have a perspective on all the stuff that's going on in the world, you would say global purification, global chemicalization. Don't focus on it, be aware of it, but be mindful of what you put in to the collective consciousness.
Well, putting some of these things together for where we are and where Christ Church is right now, is that when we lose focus, when we lose focus on what Charles Fillmore explained about the regeneration and the resurrection, and only focus on being healthy and happy here and now, we lose the whole gospel.
Yeah, exactly.
That's good.
Sure. You know, there's global connection in very short period of time here.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
the internet,
absolutely. So you can communicate, and we know when disasters happen instantly.
And before, I can't imagine what it must have felt like to live on the earth before Christ made that dissemination of grace.
Mm.
I mean, how dark?
Well, it was dark, but we've gone through periods of darkness. He did not do the work for us. He just opened the way. You know, he just created the opening. It's up to us to go within and bring forth the potential that is within us. So, yes, that's right, sleeping.
The castle is there, everybody's available and working, and she gets her finger pricked, and the vines roll up, and the thorns and the thistles and the nettles cover up the whole, all the treasure.
And Jesus is the prince that gives the kiss.
Opens the door.
Yeah, that's good. All the fairy tales are cosmic. They're wonderful. And one of my favorites is Alice in Wonderland, you know, going through down the rabbit hole.
What kind of crazy is this?
Yeah, right. And, you know, highlighting how different it is to be living in this state of human consciousness, where everything is only what you see, that's the reality. We take our notion of reality from the outer, rather than coming to know the inner reality, which can structure a different outer reality. Okay, so power, remember, power expresses from here. And that means we raise our frequency, and most people speak about words, but as you know, I did a whole service on the word. It's more about frequency here that then allows you, when you speak, to make connections with people.
You know, and you were talking before about how, you know, with love, if you have a hierarchical view of the world, and cats are below us and we're above them, and that whole thing, well, that's Alice in Wonderland, is that she doesn't realize, you know, until you go down that rabbit hole, until you see the other reality, you don't
see
the wonder of all
Yes, exactly. That there are no useless creatures or people or anything in this creation. Nothing. No spare parts, you know, no mistakes. Yeah.
And there's some kind of little scilla or something like cilia or something like that that the
binds them together
of the ants use to be able to breathe, I guess.
Amazing.
Somehow or other, so that even the bottom layer of the ants that are in the water holding up the whole structure.
Yeah, the cilia hair. Don't violate the density, the something density of the water, and so that they stay floating.
Something
like that.
Somehow or other, they connect form the raft to everybody survives.
Yes.
In a flood.
Amazing. I love that. Yeah. Yes. The animal kingdom is. You know, you can learn so much from all the animals.
But during the tsunami, it was the animals that saw the hibernate.
Yes. Right. Yeah.
Everybody else who's smart.
Yeah, that's right. Yes. Where would take people out of the world, and where would the evil be?
Are anchoring the fourth and fifth dimension.
I believe
energy
it.
For us.
Yes.
That, I mean, from the galaxy.
Yes.
Again, I lose track. I'm impressed when I read it.
Yeah. No. The animals do play a role that we fail to appreciate. Because we have a certain amount of pride that is misplaced here. We can pass around this, but the reason that spikenard is the oil is I gave you a couple of Bible stories about the anointing woman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? There's three of them are similar. I have included two of them on one sheet because Matthew and John have different details, and Luke has an entirely different point to make, but all of them use this oil. Okay. This is the story, and if you notice, there is
spikenard.
Yeah.
Nard is what Mary used to anoint Jesus.
That's right. Yes. And even though there are many details that differ from all four versions of this story, the one thing that is common is the oil that was used. Spikenard is a plant that grows way high in the Himalayas, and I think you have a picture of that. It's a kind of woody plant, has very woody root, and it was carried by cart and horse from way high in the Himalayas in these alabaster jars down to, where Jesus was. It was extremely costly. Now, in the Gospel of John, the disciples, it's Judas who is saying, This is expensive. Now, he wasn't saying, you know, like, it's just, you know, this grocery store charges more money or something like that. It wasn't like that. But it's like these oils were so precious that you had to practically be royalty in order to have them. How did Mary end up having enough money to have enough spikenard and myrrh? Myrrh was the oil of the Bible. In every event of Jesus' life, there was myrrh at his birth, at his crucifixion here.
I got a theory on that. I think Lazarus was prosperous in all ways.
Oh, I forgot that. Don't answer it. Just turn it off.
How do I ignore this button?
Okay.
And I think Mary was the younger of the two, and she got everything, and so...
Well, I don't know. But if you notice that in the main difference between the story in Matthew and the story in John is that in Matthew, Jesus was anointed on his head. And John, in the other one, she anointed his feet. All right, so what difference does that make? What does it mean if you're anointed on your head?
Wait, isn't that how was it Samuel anointed David on his head?
Yes, okay. The Jews, and Matthew is considered the Jewish gospel, Jesus was understood to be the king of the Jews. So, yes. So in his gospel, it took place and it was a lot of oil. A lot. Estimated to be about $2,000 in our terms of myrrh and spikenard. Okay. And the feet? What do the feet symbolize? What do you stand on? Understanding. So in John, in the Gospel of John, it is understood that Jesus was for all of us. You know, that the Messiah was for all of us. And so the understanding was they anointed Jesus' feet.
What you said earlier about hospitality.
Hospitality, exactly.
Humble enough to serve your guests.
Yes, and in fact, in the Gospel of Luke, hospitality is the issue. It's a parable that is a backdrop of forgiveness. And here's Jesus sitting at the table with Simon the leper, a Pharisee. Jesus, you know, he ate with everybody, with the sinners and the Pharisees and everybody. And in comes a woman. She's only named in the Gospel of John as Mary of Bethany. But in the other Gospels, she's a sinful woman, or a woman. Yes. So either a prostitute or, you know, but a woman. Feeling nature, all right? Whenever you see a woman in the Bible, it is the feeling nature. She knew, Jesus said, when the disciples complained about how expensive it was and how impractical it was, Jesus says, but you, Simon the leper, you neglected the hospitality of giving me a kiss and anointing me my feet. Who is the greater sinner, this woman or you, okay, for she performed, this was a great sin, you know, in the culture, that she would come in and pour oil on Jesus.
And Luke kind of ties them together because
yes.
because when he's reprimanding Simon, he said, "You did not anoint my head with oil, yes. And she has been wiping my feet since I sat down."
Exactly, and wiping her with her hair. Yeah.
So he kind of connects them.
Yes, that's true. So it's a different story, but in every case, the anointing, and you have these stories in your packet. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but metaphysically, what is happening here is that of all the disciples, all the people, it's only Mary, it's only the feeling nature that actually got the message, even though Jesus has said this all through his ministries, only the women who knew that what Jesus said was true, that he was going to be crucified and he would need this. And Jesus said, "She has done a beautiful thing. Save it for my burial." Okay? The disciples heard, oh, you know, we hear things, oh, yes, the world is falling apart, and yes, this is going to happen, but we don't really believe it. That's the thinking nature. But the feeling nature says, "I'm going to do something here."
And what you said earlier, you know, that if you would be first, be the servant.
Yes.
And so Matthew in this anointing anoints the king.
Yes.
And then all the way through Luke and then down to John, the king became the servant and washed the feet.
That's right. That's right. Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Very good point. And by the way, if you would like to join the discussion, 816-301-6304. It's 2:30, and I'm going to pass around Spikenard the biblical references for three of the Gospels will be on your sheets. And here is Spikenard. So now, it's a very earthy plant. It was used, it's an embalming oil. Don't think of embalming like chemicals at all. They embalmed people to preserve. And it regenerates the tissues. I love it.
I thought it was interesting that you noted here in your handouts that spikenard was from the root. Everything
yes.
else was from the bark. And the
yes, exactly.
From the root.
And it has a very woody, strong root. It's like, really. Okay. And then, myrrh. When we get to myrrh, I'll tell you. I saved myrrh, even though it goes along with frankincense, but I saved it to go with what myrrh does, exactly what you said. It just, like Queen Esther, before she married the king of Persia.
Oh, seriously.
I think it's wonderful. I love the earthy smell to it. But Esther was required to bathe for 6 months in myrrh oil to prepare her for marriage to King Ahasuerus of Persia. Yeah. Yes. But we'll get there. And notice that it says nard. And in some of the ones you'll say, well, where is the spikenard? Well, it's a different, you have to know the Hebrew in order to know that. But anyway, so that is the disciple representing. That is the oil and the disciple representing power. So power has to do with the frequency that then enters into your speech and into your action, and in fact, into your whole vision of how you view things.
And this gives me like a whole new...
I need some more water.
A whole new perspective on Philip and the feeding of the 4,000, because Jesus would not bully him. Jesus
was testing his own faculty of power.
He may have challenged Philip because Philip had it within him. Philip really had it within him, and so he challenged Philip to bring that forth. And so that says something about Philip.
But remember, this is all about one consciousness. So I see all of these as Jesus testing out one by one each of the faculties, because he's going to need all of them to go through the crucifixion and resurrect. Okay, so Philip, I was going to say something about Philip, and I've lost it.
Writing on that,
testing all the faculties.
The science is you remember 8% of what you hear, but 92% of what you teach. And so in teaching, in bringing up these faculties, Jesus was acquiring them.
Okay, and also in the feeding of the 5,000, this appears in all four Gospels, only in some it says 4,000, but Philip, not just Philip, but Jesus goes up to a high place. No, that is code for going up into higher consciousness, and the first thing he does... is he says, make the people sit down. Who are these people? You're thinking 5,000, right? What are those 5,000 people? Who are those 5,000 people within you? Thoughts. Okay, that's exactly right. We have a bazillion thoughts, and Jesus says to, I don't remember if it's Andrew or Peter. Anyway, make the people sit down. Become still. Okay. All right. Now, five. Five represents senses. All right. And zeros emphasize it. All right. So all of these are like human thoughts. We are besieged by colonies of thoughts. All right. And so the first step, make them sit down. And they have to sit on the grass. Okay.
I'm following your...
Quiet. And they sit down on the grass. And then it's Andrew who says, Andrew, that quiet disciple. The rest of them don't have a clue as to how to feed them. They don't have, convenience stores, and nobody can run out and bring in some Chinese or something. And so Andrew says, but here is a lad. Okay, now a lad is a boy, but it's an immature boy. So this is an immature thought, idea of how you manifest what you need. And this boy has, he says, Andrew says, but here's a lad, he has two fish, five loaves and two fish. What does loaves symbolize? What are the loaves? They're bread, so yeah. But what is substance? All right, substance. We live in a sea of substance, and the fish. Two. There's two of them. So what's the two? Divine.
Conflict. One or the other.
Not conflict. Affirmation and denial. Okay. Remember the keys. The keys to the kingdom. There are two keys, on the Pope's hat, two keys. Yeah. Those were the keys given to Peter. Yeah. Okay. So you have infinite substance. You have denial and affirmation. And so Jesus blesses the loaves and the fish. And that's it. And there was enough for everyone with 12 baskets left over. So the faculty, not only was there a sufficiency to take care of the moment, but the 12 baskets left over served to nourish his faculties. Okay. All right. Metaphysics requires that you take each character or each situation, and this one, here's the, you look for the spiritual principle behind it. This is what power is, that if you find a penny on the ground, have the awareness that that is not just a penny, but it's an expression of the infinite substance behind it. I love to find pennies. It's considered good luck to find pennies, but I know someone who actually threw pennies away, named Greg Netler. He actually threw them away. He made a confession one day. No, and it's like you may have a little bit of whatever, but bless what you have. Because blessing connects you to the source where the infinite substance is.
What did you say the metaphysical meaning of fish, of a fish?
Ideas. They're divine ideas in this case. That's Jerry, by the way. It's hard to know.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's hard to know. Not food, for sure. Okay. But if he wants to go out, sometimes it's that.
So just because it's in the middle of the year. So when he sent the disciples to get the drachma from the mouth of the fish to pay the poll tax.
Yeah.
So the drachma and the fish.
Yeah, an idea. Right?
Oh, so if they think it, they can have it.
That's right. As in mind, so in manifestation.
Wow, that's wild.
Okay. Now, there's that's the law. And many people, when they first come to Unity, get very excited because now they know the law. All right? Thoughts held in mind produce after their kind, all right? But that does not build a consciousness of abundance. You have to go to the source and experience it. And at some point, if you really have some conscious awareness, would you do me a favor? You really have to come to understand the reality that the substance, the abundance, is there. It's just like faith. You have to know it's there. And if you have no doubt, thank you, it's there, you can say, let there be light, and there is light. And let there be a firmament. And let there be whatever. And there's no gap in between your desire and the manifestation of it. But anybody can work the law. I can put my attention on money for all week, you know, and probably I'd find more pennies on the ground. But that doesn't actually build a consciousness of abundance. Unity, this is one of my favorite stories about the founding of Unity, is that when Unity Incorporated, then you get a board. And one day the lady who was in charge of the board, and by the way, Unity was founded, you know, by a woman named Myrtle Fillmore, just the president or whatever of the board said, what was her name? Anyway, she said, we need to have our own place. And she put a penny down as the beginning of a building fund, I guess you would call it. And by the end of the year, it had gone up to 25 cents. But just this notion of knowing that there is more, somebody came along and said, oh, I'm going to mortgage my property so you can have this place. And that's how Ninth and Tracy came about, from a penny. All right. It's not the penny, it's the notion, the consciousness of what is behind the penny. So if you find yourself saying, I only have this much, then refer to your affirmation sheet. That is not an affirmation of power. That is saying, there may be infinite abundance, but I don't have access to it. But you do have access to it. Is anyone going to call in? There is still 12 minutes. I will give you an opportunity. So we have had spikenard. Everyone has smelled some spikenard. And
so we think it, what is the consciousness of abundance?
A consciousness of abundance is just what I was talking about, that if you find a penny on the ground, the reason it's considered good luck is that wherever you see something manifest, you know that the infinite substance is behind it.
Okay, so it's what it points to. It's
like you become aware that no matter what the denomination of money, if look at the widow's mite, what is given freely and with love returns to us multiplied. Okay, yeah. Yes, so it's a consciousness of abundance, the reality of that it's really there. It's really there. And God wants you to have it. Because, and what did Jesus say? I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. So we're supposed to have it. Now, it's not about having, what about having exactly what you need? I think of Peace Pilgrim. She had what she needed. She didn't have money, but she had exactly what she needed. And I think that what brings the fulfillment is not the amount of money, but of the balance, the balance of giving and receiving that has to be maintained. And so, for instance, if you have a job that you really don't like, and you're doing it because it brings you money just that you need, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that, but if you want a consciousness of abundance, then you give fully of yourself to whatever your task is, knowing, and this is the Fillmore covenant, knowing that the universe will provide for you, but not making any of these things the object of your existence. That is what is at the basis of the unity idea, of Jesus' idea here in this story of a consciousness of abundance. So Jesus knew all along what he was going to do in that story of the 5,000. Okay, but for metaphysical interpretation, remember there is an idea behind every symbol, that every single thing in that passage has a place in a landscape of consciousness within you. There is that infinite substance within you. You have the tools, you have the power to deny power to what you've given power to, if it's just a little bit, and you have the power to affirm the truth. And if you are sitting down, if you are in a quiet state, then you can use those tools and they will be effective. And then you know that your power of your faculty of power is maximally being used. And here, with all the bazillions of thoughts that bombard us every day, and as someone said, I think it's 150,000 thoughts that we have during the day on average, and about 149,999 of them are the same thoughts we had yesterday. Yeah. And so the whole idea of new thought is to have one. Yeah. And it is a new thought to know that there is an infinite sea of substance. And who represents that infinite sea of substance? Chuck, do you know?
What's that?
No, who represents the infinite sea of substance in the Bible?
Oh, Jesus.
Well, Mary. Jesus represents the Christ. Okay. Mary represents the Holy Spirit.
Oh, really?
Yes. The Holy Spirit isn't... The Holy Spirit is like an emanation that comes forth when we breathe life into our ideas.
You know, I didn't notice that there was an Old Testament person of power in this lesson.
No, and I don't know one. But you could, because they're negative examples. I mean, you could say Herod. Okay.
Old Testament.
Any of kings. There were plenty of bad kings, but kings represent more the faculty of will, willful.
What about Samuel?
About
Samuel, since he called David out on killing the
pagan. Nathan's a prophet. He made David face up to what he had actually done. I would definitely, because I named my first son Nathan, so I would definitely consider that one as a possibility. But in terms of the kind of spiritual power, how about, Elisha or Elijah, who are kind of precursors of Jesus anyway.
He raised from the dead. He took on all priests of Baal.
That's true.
I mean, he heard the still small voice.
I nominate Elijah because it was Elijah who discovered the still small voice, that God was not in the earthquakes and the fire, and God was in the still small voice, and he transformed. Okay, I'm going to say Elijah. He represents all the prophets, but he developed that power that comes from silence. He was the first one that I can remember doing that. Anyway, for those of you out there, the streaming is going to stop in 5 minutes. For those of you here, you can stay as long as you want today. Smell oils, take samples home with you. And your assignment, how about an assignment? Because tomorrow we're going to talk about imagination, the faculty of imagination. And so in Genesis, if you would read about Joseph, all right? Please read. Joseph is the representative in the Old Testament of imagination. And the prophets, now you pick anyone you want in the New Testament, the prophets, especially the ones, and I'm going to nominate Ezekiel, but you can read a little bit of anyone you want. And then we'll talk about what that faculty of imagination does. It can't function on its own. It's like imagination is pure fantasy if you sit there and daydream about all the things that you don't have. But from a place of power in the silence, there are visions. And these prophets quite often had visions. And they got crucified for them, but, you know, that's the occupational hazard, you might say.
Ooh, Isaiah chapter 6.
Isaiah? Oh, yes. True. Yeah. Okay. So, thank you all in cyberspace. If you had a chance to tune in, this class will be archived as soon as Mark gets around to it. And for those of you here, let's just close our eyes for a moment and come together to remember the truth that all of these faculties are awakening within us to sustain us and to provide channels from the Christ of our being into manifestation. And we say, thank you, God. Amen. And if out there you would like to contribute to New Foundation Unity, you may do so on the website. And next time we will be covering more faculties. So hope to see you again. And that's tomorrow, 1 to 3, same time, same station. And thank you. God bless you all.